Thank you everybody for coming. My research is based on the use of optical fibers for the monitoring of potable water. So I will start my presentation with the 17 sustainable goals set by the United Nations. Probably many of you have already heard, but for those of you who haven't, the goals, there are 17 goals which cover a wide range of today's emerging problems in the world, starting from poverty, gender equality, education, climate change, peace, etc. The goals are set in 2015, and the aim to be accomplished is the year 2030. So soon we are entering in the last 10 years of the deadline. I will focus my presentation only on the sixth goal, which is clean water and sanitation, as also the title suggests. Ensure availability and sustainable management of water and sanitation for all is considered to be the resolved situation of this goal. But first, I would like to go through some facts to better understand how the situation is nowadays with clean water and sanitation. Water scarcity affects more than 40% of the world's total population. And by water scarcity, here it doesn't mean only the total lack of water, but it also means the cases where the water is provided, but probably not safe enough to be exploited. 785 million people remain without even basic drinking water, and this is due to 2017. In this case, we are talking about a fact which shows an enormous number of people which are directly, let's say, suffering from thirsty. And 2 out of 5 people worldwide do not have basic hand washing facility with soap and water at home. This fact shows a very similar number to the first fact, but in this case, we are talking about direct hygiene facilities which all of us have at our home, but 40% of the people in the world do not have. And last but not least, I will close with another fact which doesn't require a lot of comments. Each day, nearly 1,000 children die due to preventable water and sanitation-related diarrheal diseases. I pass through all these facts just to remind us all how crucial and how emerging the problem of water and sanitation in the world is nowadays. And now I will move the focus a little bit to the cases where the water service and the water infrastructure already exist a little bit. And how do these cities or countries provide such a service and guarantee such a service? Periodically, meaning yearly or even monthly in some cases, in different points of the distribution infrastructure, there is some water which is sampled and then transported into specialized laboratory in order to perform specialized analysis, like bacteriological analysis, physiochemical analysis, including chlorine residuals, pH and turbidity, aesthetic analysis, including color, taste, and odor of the water, and some other parameters like fluoride, nitrate, arsenic, chromium, and other minerals which can be dissolved, which can be found dissolved in water. But in most of the cases, this procedure is quite complicated, not only the analysis itself, but also the sampling and the transportation of the water, because water does not maintain its characteristics for a long time after it is taken out of the system. So everything, the sampling, the transportation, and the analysis should be completed within very few hours. But is there a parameter which connects all these characteristics of water in a single one? Me, as someone who works with optics, I've thought of refractive index, but definitely you can also find other parameters probably. So refractive index of water is around 1.33 and is disposed to change with respect to any of the previously mentioned parameters that I already mentioned. And some of them might impact the refractive index of the water more and some of them a little less, but they impact it very similarly. So it's really hard to characterize any of those parameters one by one with respect to the refractive index. So how are we thinking to exploit the refractive index of water for its own analysis? We have come up with two ideas. And both of them are based in defining a safe range of the refractive index for potable water and a non-safe one. One idea is to place sensors in important spots of already existing water distribution infrastructure in cases where it already exists. And to create an alertarizing system, which would raise an alert every time some unexpected situation is occurring and when the water is not safe to be exploited. And the other case probably aimed to be used in underdeveloped or developing countries would be to create a portable device, user-friendly one, which everybody can have at his home, and analyze the water that is provided to him or her in real time, and to understand if this water that is provided is clean enough to be exploited. And this water provided can be probably even from rivers or from the tap water if it's provided in, let's say, in different times and not continuously. So, which is the phenomenon that we have selected in order to sense the refractive index? There are a lot of ways to sense the refractive index of liquids. I will talk about a phenomenon called surface plasmon resonance, and I will try to make it as simple as possible. So in the figure, it is shown a glass substrate, and on one side of the substrate, it is placed a gold surface, which can be any metal, but it's selected gold for a specific reason. So in any ordinary case, when light hits a metal interface, what happens is that the biggest part of the light gets reflected back. But also, in the same time, the light penetrates in a little depth of the metal surface. It penetrates in this little depth, it excites the electrons, and the electrons all together oscillate and absorb some of this energy with their oscillation. So what is happening is a big part is getting reflected, and the smaller part is getting absorbed and converted into heat. But what if this gold surface, this gold layer, this metal layer, is so thin that it's even thinner than this penetration depth? If we imagine this situation, again, the light will hit the metal interface, and it will penetrate through all the layer now, because the layer is so thin that it's like the light can penetrate even deeper. So what will happen is that the electrons of all the layer now will get excited from the light, and they will start oscillating synchronously. This oscillation is what we call the surface plasmon resonance, surface plasmon oscillation, and it can be looked as a plasma wave which propagates along the surface in a parallel direction. And this oscillation indeed is also affected by the outer medium on the other side, which in our case is the water. So this is how we discriminate the refractive index of the water, by looking at the oscillation frequency or wavelength of the light which is mostly absorbed. If we want to see it from another perspective, we can see it like a photon is coupled with an electron and it's creating a plasmon, which is considered to be the quantistic particle of the surface plasma wave. Or even in simpler words, it would be that the plasmon is dancing with the music which is played by the electrons and the photons. So this is how we discriminate the surface plasmon resonance, the refractive index of the water from the physical point of view. And we exploit this phenomenon using optical fibers. We take large core multimode optical fibers with a diameter of 400 micron. And in this case, the optical fiber would replace the glass substrate that I showed in the image before. We strip off the polymeric cladding in a length of 1 to up to 3 centimeters, and this is going to be the sensitive part of our sensor. And on this stripped length, we deposit our metal layer. In our case, the metal layer is composed of 20 nanometers of titanium and 40 nanometers of gold. We have chosen titanium only for adhesion purposes because it sticks better with the glass substrate, with the glass core in this case. And the gold is the preferred material for the plasmon phenomenon because it makes the plasmon phenomenon occur in the visible range. So it's our preferred range. The sensitivity of our sensors are sensitive to a refractive index range from 1.33 to 1.38, but we tend to exploit them mostly on the 1.33 range because it's the refractive index of water plus or minus some inquinants that we are looking for. The architectures that we are mainly using with our sensors are in transmission, so we exploit them in transmission. And the methods are two. One is the wavelength interrogation, for which the equipment required is a wide broadband light in the visible range, an optical-based sensor that we produce by ourselves, a spectrum analyzer, and a PC. What happens is the light is coupled into the fiber. It propagates along the fiber, where it also interacts with the sensitive region, where is the gold layer deposited. And then it goes to the spectrometer, which analyzes the spectrum of this light. And the plots and the plots that we receive are very similar to the ones shown in the figure on this angle here. The curves appear with a dip, which red shifts in case of an increase in effective index, and blue shifts in case of a decrease in effective index. The other method that we exploit is the intensity interrogation. In this case, we do not focus anymore on the full spectrum of the light, but instead we focus only on a single wavelength, which we determine on one of the shoulders of the curves, and we focus on the intensity of this wavelength, which can be excited by a laser or even a colored LED. So we analyze the intensity in this wavelength while the curve is shifting on the background, let's say like this. So this intensity interrogation is quite simpler, let's say. As for my research, I have to work in two different aspects. One is simulation, and the other one is the experimental work that I do in the laboratory. As for the simulations, I have created a mathematical model both for the multilayer structure, but also for the phenomenon itself. And the multilayer structure is composed of the core, the two metal layers, and the water. The key parameters of the simulations are the refractive index of each material, considering also the dispersion, so the dependency of the wavelength of the materials, of the refractive index of the materials, and also the imaginary part of the effective index in case of the metals, because those are the ones responsible for the absorption of the light. Another important parameter is the thickness of each layer, which are the ones that determine the penetration depth of the field. But also in case of the core, the thickness of the core is very important because it defines the number of the interactions within the sensitive length. So also the sensitive length is very important. And the numerical aperture of the fiber is also very important because the numerical aperture is the one which determines which angle are allowed to propagate along the fiber. I start the calculations by firstly calculating the elementary reflective coefficients of each interface. In this case, there are three interfaces, by considering the characteristic impedance of each material for the specific polarization. And then moving to the second equation, I exploit these elementary reflective coefficients to calculate the reflectivity of a three-layer structure. And in our case, the structure is four-layered, so we have to make this iteratively two times. And then the total reflectivity, once we have it, then we place it on the third formula in this case to calculate the total power transmitted, which is dependent on the reflectivity itself, the number of the reflections that the light does within the sensitive length, but also on the polarization of the incoming light, which can be, let's say, P or S or T or TM in other words. The curves that we obtain from the simulations, here I've shown two of them. One of them is the blue curve is obtained by considering 1.33 as the external refractive index. Instead, the red curve is obtained by showing 1.35 as the refractive index. And I've shown these curves to notice some parameters which are really important to our calculations in order to better analyze the performance of our sensors. The important parameters are the full width at half maximum, which should, like, more exactly, it would be full width at half depth because there is not a maximum, but it's a depth. And the depth itself is also important. So deeper is the curve, it means that it's easier to be detected. And also the sensitivity. The sensitivity here is described as a shift in nanometers for a change in refractive index unit. So we use these three quality parameters, let's call them like this, in order to rank our sensors according to their performance. So we can change the design parameters and choose the best one according to these three parameters. Talking about the experimental part of my work, here I've shown graphs obtained experimentally during a stability test of 24 hours. The curves are very similar to the ones we saw in the simulation slide. And they seem to converge quite well with time. So here are plots, here are curves shown every 4 hours of a 24 hours test. And they seem to converge quite well. But actually, a very small variation in the peak, a very small shift in the peak of the curves, due to the high sensitivity of such sensors, is very critical. It would be translated to quite important refractive index modification. So this is I've showed this graph on purpose in order to show the importance of the stability of our sensors. Even these small instabilities, we are trying to figure out. We think we have kind of figured out the reason, so we are trying to work on them in order to make the system even more stable, because it's a very important fact in the case of the first alternative that I proposed, to place our sensors in different points in already existing infrastructures, because this means they are going to be set there for a long time, and for a long time the system needs to be stable and not to give false alarms. And as I proposed another option, which was a compact user-friendly device, the idea is to create now a device which is small enough. In this case, it can be as long as the sensitive length, which goes up to maximum 3 centimeters, so it can be a device of 3 centimeters, using a colored LED, which is a red LED in this case, and also a photodiode on the other side, and to place all the circuitry and the power supply in as minimum space as possible. We have already proven the proof of concept, the concept of this kind of sensor, but with benchtop equipment like power supplies and circuitries. And now we're going to move on to smaller pieces and to see if the performance will deteriorate or maybe it will improve. So we're going to calculate a bit the trade-off. So with this slide, I will conclude, and I thank you for your attention. If you have questions, please.